So my name is John Stehlin. I am a lecturer in the geography department here. I finished my degree last May, so I taught two summers, not actually teaching this summer, but I taught two summers last summer and the summer before, both the Geography 70 AC course, which is the urban experience. So I'll be talking kind of a little bit more about some of the teaching methods that I used, which were sort of historical and geographical and getting people out of the classroom, actually, as well. So, and I'm happy to see you all.
Hi, everyone. My name is Justin Gomer. I teach in American Studies. I did my PhD in African American Studies. I was also an undergraduate here, so I took a number of AC courses as a student. And I've taught AC in the summer for, I want to say, the last 6 years or so. I started it, you know, in grad school. So the AC courses I teach in the summer generally are Ethnic Studies 10 AC, which is the intro to Ethnic Studies class. I've also taught a few American Studies courses as AC classes, as well as a film class in African American Studies.
So let's see here. What we wanted to do, this is like the sort of basic schedule here. We're in the sort of welcoming coffee and introductions. We'll talk a little bit first about just teaching summer period, you know, some more kind of mechanical, procedural, logistical types of questions. And then we'll break for lunch, and then Doug will talk a little bit more about the history of the American culture's requirements specifically, and then some more specific aspects of teaching American culture's courses, especially racial economic justice, teaching diversity, issues with, you know, students who are just there to fulfill the requirement as cheaply as possible, things like that. So, and then that'll bring us through to reflections and final questions and stuff. But so some of the questions, and we generated these from some of what people filled out in the forms when they signed up, but also some of what got filled out in the forms when we did this last year as well. It's sort of, there are a lot of questions that recur. So the first one is, I think most of you mentioned this, what kinds of students can we expect to have? Your experience?
Yeah, I think for me, the summers bring a far more diverse group of students than I'm accustomed to in the semesters. Because you have, on the one hand, students that are balancing scheduling conflicts to where summers are times when they have a lot more flexibility to knock off some of their requirements. To also, you know, on the more kind of cynical end, have students who, especially in the AC courses, who might not be all that on board with taking an AC course, and so they see the summer as the fastest way to take this requirement that they see as sort of silly. And you also get a lot of international students coming and spending a summer at Berkeley. So I think for me, what's always unique about summer is I find myself teaching to several different demographics simultaneously. That on the one hand can be really exciting and kind of can create really interesting class dialogue and discussion that is unique from what happens in the fall or the spring, but also can present certain challenges because folks are at different sort of points, right? That when I'm teaching a major requirement, you know, in let's say ethnic studies, to have students that are very invested in the material, are planning to kind of take this as their major, have a much kind of more extensive familiarity with the ideas in the course, as opposed to someone who is just satisfying their AC requirement, and this was the one that worked around their summer internship or work schedule, and so they want to get in and get out and you know, and that's the extent of it, to groups of international students who are dealing with sort of language issues, or this is their kind of first time in the United States. So shared histories, or, you know, that we, I imagine when I, if you say something like the Civil War, that doesn't mean the same thing. So that's sort of my experience, that there's a much wider range of who you're dealing with.
Yeah, I had a similar experience the past few times I taught. I'd say about a third of the students were international students, and there was a variety of familiarity or comfort in English. A lot of people express themselves in writing quite well in English, but were extremely hesitant in class to kind of step up and share. And, you know, their writing was good, and it was this sort of disjunct where you don't know until, say, that first assignment, kind of where people are, and then it's kind of a surprise. So actually, yeah, that relates to how you structure the course, kind of getting a sense of where people are at fairly early is helpful. I occasionally got a master's student or two, an international master's student. I think my experience was pretty similar with you, especially since one of the mandates, especially for teaching the AC course at least, is some engagement with American history, or at least American context, and that's can be construed in a lot of different ways. Could be construed globally, but yeah, these kind of, you know, the Civil War, you might get that question, which one? You know,
that
kind of assuming within the AC curriculum a lot of familiarity with U.S. history, or kind of U.S. history globally construed, that people aren't necessarily just working intuitively with, say, put it that way. I did, you know, we saw that some people had questions about proofreading resources. I don't know, do you have anything to add about resources for writing papers for international students who are having language difficulty?
Yeah, I tend to just send it on the CD shots.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that they have a lot of resources there, and they're great there. So that's become sort of my crutch of just, you need to go make appointments.
Yeah.
The one, just a quick kind of side that I would say is, in my experience, there tends to be more international students the later your session is.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's just the way that Berkeley schedules their sort of summer abroad programs, but I found that when I teach session A, which is kind of right, you know, late May to July 4th, there are fewer international students than when I've taught session D or E, right, the kind of July to August session. Maybe that's just an anomaly for me, but that seemed to be the case.
The English Language Institute,
uh-huh,
through college writing, is always in Section B.
So I think that's probably the reason.
Oh, all right. Yeah, I've only ever taught in Section A, actually. So
okay. Yeah.
That's good to know.
Is anyone teaching Section E by chance, the 3-week session? Okay, that's a whole. All right, yeah, we're not sure. It's a whole other workshop.
Wow, yeah.
Yeah,
that sounds,
it's a whole other
that
workshop.
Sounds like a challenge.
Yeah.
There was one thing.
Resources for.
Yeah, there was something else that jogged my memory about something. It'll come back to me.
But I think the challenge really becomes, okay, I have a third of my students who don't have a sort of good enough sense of American history to deal with what we're dealing with today. So does that mean that we stop and rehash all of this, which then the other two-thirds of my students are like, well, this is boring, this is high school U.S., this is AP U.S. history all over again. Or do I find a way to give them something, you know, something kind of additional, supplemental to read, right? That moving forward, think like, oh, well, they might want to take a look at some kind of survey U.S. history book, give them, you know, something. But then you're adding more reading, you know, so I think that I've handled it differently in different contexts, and I don't know that there is the set, this is how you handle this, because ultimately we are teaching college-level courses,
right,
and we can't, you know, slow the class down or sort of lower the intellectual standards of it to the point that some students might require, given their lack of context with American culture, especially in the AC sense.
Yeah, the one thing that I remember, there was also a pretty big disparity in terms of how many courses people were taking. You know, some people are knocking off one course per session, but I had students, especially the, you know, the exchange students who were taking three courses. And it was like, the mind reels, actually, like how they could actually, you know, fit all that in. So that's another thing to, and it didn't occur to me to ask what other courses people might be taking, because my experience, at least as a GSI, was, well, people are taking sort of regular full load, but in the summer it's a lot more variable. So, what's up next here? Well, yeah, this fits right in. How do you lesson plan, right? You know, you were saying that you don't want to just, A, you don't, how you want to run a class to just kind of talk at people for 2 hours, but especially given questions of uneven familiarity, you know, how you manage these sort of long class periods. Mine were 2.5 hours, 3 days a week. Is that where other people are, or? Or some 2 hours,
yeah,
4 days a week?
I have a 2-4.
2-4, okay. That's almost a little bit easier, but it's not easy. I'll say what I did and then hand it off, which was, I think the first time I taught it, I was like, this is the first time I'm teaching a class. Like, I'm, you know, it's got a theme, it's got an arc, it's got an argument, that kind of stuff. And because of this, of the issue of needing to sort of fill out all of the information, I found myself having lecturing more than I wanted to. And then my feedback from that class was it would be nice to have more discussion, etc. So what I did actually in lieu of discussion, which I think I did do a lot of discussion in the second time I taught it, but in lieu of just that sort of discussion where people who aren't that comfortable or like tried really hard to do the reading and got like 5 pages in and it took them 2 hours to do that, kind of shrink back and it becomes that same kind of section where people were unprepared for that day, but it's kind of not really their fault in this case. I did a lot of exercises because I was teaching an urban theory, urban history course. Like, I had them using census data, I had them using some of the online historical archives, such as this relates as well to the AC mandate, but the online archives of historical redlining, for instance, where you can actually look at the texts that were used to evaluate a particular neighborhood on the basis of race. And so things like that, that A, it breaks up the time, and B, it kind of gives them some kind of practical skills. They can play around with census data mapping, like Social Explorer, for instance, and kind of, you can have an interesting conversation about why is, again, this is the AC question, but so why is white in the census really distinct from our kind of common sense notions of what white is, for instance. You can have an interesting conversation about data and representation, all that kind of stuff. So I felt that those kind of practical exercises where people were like, well, I kind of didn't understand any of the readings, but now I have a sense of how I would go about learning more about a particular urban space. I felt like that was more successful the second time around.
Yeah, I think I would just echo John's point that doing too much lecturing is really gonna kind of undermine your ability to have a successful class. So the way that I tend to structure my weeks is, my approach is always, I want to cram as much information as I can into a week that students can actually digest. And how are the ways that I can do that? Basically, not tricking, but how can I get them to kind of consume more than they otherwise would have if it was just read this, listen to this lecture? So for me, what that ends up being, and part of this is, you know, doing a humanities course, is I end up having, if I'm doing the kind of 3 days a week, I have one very kind of long lecture that usually starts the week, frames the kind of historical era, the theoretical ideas that we're going to cover, and that'll be about a 2-hour lecture. And then we usually will have a film screening, and then on the third day, we will try to put everything for the week together. So that what they read that week, the movie they watched that week and the lecture that they heard, that becomes the work of sort of suturing everything together. And in that way, I found that, and we'll get into later, like what kind of things should you assign, that I can assign my students a lot more material, and that discussion sections are a lot more lively because they've sort of had three texts. They've had, you know, a lecture, they've had a movie, and then they've typically read a book. And so then we can have that last 2.5 hour block where it's on them to figure out, you know, I start very, like, why did I put these three things together? How do we, you know, what are the connections? How can we read this film as a historical document? How do we see the theories we talk, you know? And we just start working through. And I bring, you know, I have the movie queued up and ready, so if someone brings up a clip, you know, I can show the clip right away. And we, oh yeah, let's watch it, let's work on, you know, let's do some actual formal film analysis, or let's go to that, you know, scene in the novel we read and let's kind of talk about it. And so that tends to be how I do my summer classes, is if it's four days a week, we are going to watch a movie one of those days. And so sometimes, you know, sometimes on a 4-day week, there'll be kind of two lectures. But one of the things I really believe is, I really think it's flawed to think about condensing a semester into a summer. I think you have to think of summer as its own thing. That, you know, the units might kind of equate on a student's transcript, but if it's going to be a successful class, you have to think about what you can and can't do in 6 weeks. And so my goal is always not to take a semester course and condense it down into a summer, but to think about what's the most we can do in 6 weeks. And that is, to me, as an instructor, that's my sort of obligation to students. And whatever the, you know, whatever the requirements are for a unit, whatever, I don't really care about that. I think it's my job to make sure that they have a worthwhile 6 weeks and learn as much as they can. And that's what I do. And I mean, part of this is being kind of on the humanities cultural studies, and that we're always doing sort of primary texts anyway. So, you know, that's kind of what American studies and ethnic studies is always doing. So that might be a little different for folks in different fields. But yeah, my weeks are always going to have multiple texts, but delivered in sort of different ways.
Yeah, I mean, that goes right to our next. Are any of you teaching the 10-week? Everyone's in 6 weeks.
You had a question.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, I was just going to ask, so how do you fit technology into your class, both in terms of, like, if you're giving a lecture or a mini-lecture or something, are you using PowerPoint, or is that weird in, like, a group of 30 or however big? And then I guess the second question was, like, are the students, do you have them on their laptops or not? And, like, how do you find that that's, like, alienating or useful?
That's a good question. My experience, and this probably differs for you, but my experience is I'll sort of ban laptops for the most part, but tell them to bring them and have them in their bags, and then we'll break out. And usually what I'll do, and you'll get some reluctance where, like, students just, like, want to be by themselves, and you have to kind of, like, massage them into groups. Yeah, you'll get a little bit of reluctance about that, but I usually do say, if you're working with census data, like, you're working in groups of two or three, and I'll kind of type up a sheet of, you know, familiarizing yourself with this particular interface, you know, whether it is the redlining archives or whether it's the census data from the Social Explorer, et cetera. Those are the two that leap to mind, but there's a lot of different things that they can look at, and that way it's sort of like they don't just have the laptop in front of them that whole time. One thing that's tough is that, especially students who are trying to do things on a shoestring, I kind of provide a lot of the readings online, and so they will have read them. I mean, this is baffling to me, but, like, read them on their phones, you know, and it's like they are on their phones, they're probably doing multiple things, not just looking at the reading, but it's impossible for me to imagine that, like, engaging with the text that way, but it's just it's a different world in many ways. But yeah, I think what you said was exactly right. I don't think it's actually, and it's especially hard if you know, are doing your PhD, you just came off your qualifying exams especially, and you're like, I have all these great readings, I love all of these, they're all, like, you know, special snowflakes to you, and they are not that to the students. You know? you know, less is more in many kids, and you know, it's like each time I've had to cut and cut and cut just as
yeah,
a sort of realism.
Yeah, can you just be more specific? How many pages do you assign per day or week?
I assign a book every week, but
okay.
I assign only primary material in summers.
Yeah.
I don't do any scholarly idea that I want to communicate, I lecture and I walk them through.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because secondary sources, academic journal articles, they just don't.
It doesn't.
Yeah.
So the
it's
way I get
too much to digest.
Exactly.
That.
So the way I get around that is say, okay, we're gonna read every week we're gonna read a novel or a memoir
yeah.
or some nonfiction book that's more kind of like a trade press nonfiction.
Yeah.
And that way you're gonna read 200 to 300 pages every week, but you're gonna get to read a Toni Morrison novel.
Right.
Right. So you want instead of giving you 100 pages of American Quarterly articles or Journal of American History articles,
yeah.
fine. You won't have to read the dense stuff. I'll lecture kind of what you need to get at, what the ideas are, what the arguments are. But then what you're gonna do in turn is you're gonna read novels every week.
Yeah.
So I do a book just about every so that way they
but
get a lecture
really per week, not per
yeah.
class meeting.
Yeah, that's what I think of
that's
every
fresh.
Week as its own unit
yeah.
in the summer.
And do you even assign it that way? Do you just say, you know, by Monday or Tuesday, whatever, have the book done, or do you have
No, I have it so that the last day of the week is our discussion day.
Uh-huh.
And I will say that you need to come to that day having read the bluest eye, right?
Uh-huh.
That, so you can figure out how you want to do that, how you want to break it up. If you want to stay up all night, then I don't
yeah.
care. But you will come that day, and we will talk about that novel. So that's generally the way that I do it. That everything is due, readings, writing, whatever, on the discussion day.
Mm-hmm.
So students managing multiple classes, different sorts of schedules can plan it out accordingly. So that way, I think that every week there's three texts. There's my lecture. There's a movie, a film, or and then there's the book.
You do the film in class or
in class?
In
yeah.
class.
Yeah. Yeah, and you know when Justin and I have been talking about this, I'm like, wow, that's way better way to run it than I did. You know, so it's like it's kind of a constant learning experience. I think that I definitely became more attuned to. I tended to assign nonfiction stuff, especially the you know. And I'll say a little bit more about assignments, I think it's coming up, but assigning, you know, sometimes I would have a scholarly article, but it probably wouldn't be like one of the heaviest lifting kinds of ones. You know, one of the ones that comes to mind that I sort of cribbed from a friend was, you know, George Lipsitz writing about Mardi Gras Indians, where there's a lot of like description and then tied in with clips. I do a lot more sort of like interspersing lecture clips, and Giselle can say more about the resources that are available for that. I will say that it was not something that came up for me teaching in summer, but teaching this semester, I do a lot of clips. I use things like KeepVid, you know, your pirating things from YouTube, etc. You can like edit that little bit out, but it's very hard to integrate subtitles into that particular method. And even the automatically generated YouTube subtitles I used a couple times, and they're just incomprehensible. So for students, bless you, who have hearing impairment, that's another, you know, working from the DVDs is a much better strategy in that particular context.
I mean, we can come up with different strategies depending on what video you're using. There's also ways in YouTube, which I should show you, where you can correct some of those subtitles if you have time. I mean, summer is time prohibitive for that.
Yeah.
Especially if you have a DSP student, there's resources available to get that stuff done for
yeah.
you. But also for the English language learners, they really benefit from having those subtitles. So
yeah.
for summer, it's
yeah. Let's see. So yeah, I mean, the next thing that I was going to go over was something, you know, if it's a journal article, it's like, you know, you're looking at maybe about 75 pages a week, and that's on the high side, especially if you think of, you know, basically a journal article or a chapter from like a trade press type of nonfiction book. I mean, say, for instance, Matthew Desmond's Evicted that just came out. I think you get away with a few chapters from that. It's very, very, very colloquial. There's like, you know, one or two pages of sort of heavier lifting, and there's lots of footnotes, which I always include anytime I'm, you know, just scanning one chapter. I always include all the footnotes and encourage people to read them, which makes my readers longer and more expensive, maybe. But that's how you can maybe scratch that itch of like wanting to include all of your babies from the orals list or from like a full length class without actually doing that, which people don't necessarily appreciate.
Another thing I like to do, I also like to bring, especially in summer, to bring music in, right? That it gives them a little break. You can also start to think, you know, especially if you're doing an AC course, right, American culture, right, so the idea is that we're really kind of foregrounding culture. So, you know, in my ethnic studies 10A's, my kind of Black Power Week, right, there's sort of a lecture about the social history of the Black Panther, because my class is Race in California. So we talk a lot about, like, the Black Panthers in the lecture, but then we also listen to James Brown Say Aloud, I'm Black and I'm Proud, and Nina Simone To Be Young, Gifted, and Black, and then they read Toni Morrison's The Bluest Eye, right, so that the idea, and then they watch a Black independent film from the mid-70s, you know, so the idea is that they're just getting, I mean, what the kind of idea is, like, the structure of feeling is sort of the theoretical idea, right, that you're getting just a sense of what this time looked and felt like, and we're not going to get all of the sort of fine detail that I would love to kind of assign in all these great new books about the Black Panther Party, right, so, you know, Walden Martin, who's a professor here, has a brand new book about the Black Panther Party. That's amazing. And so what I want to assign is like, well, just go read that. But I realize like they're not going to want to do that. So, okay, instead, well, let's read Toni Morrison. We can, you know, I also supplement that with like some poetry by Nikki Giovanni. Let's like talk about like what the artists are doing. Let's listen to what kind of musicians are doing. And I'll kind of march you through the social history part, right? The nuts and bolts on like what's happening year to year. Yeah, so that's kind of the way that I again, that idea of like how can I trick them into consuming more than they otherwise would have, that's sort of been my way of doing that. It's not really tricking them, it's just they can kind of take more of it.
You just digest.
Yeah, exactly, you just digest, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And would you fit a work of secondary scholarship into your lecture, either implicitly or explicitly, and do you kind of encourage them to do research for their final project, or still no on there?
The final project, different thing. The one thing I encourage that they have to do in their final project, the one theory, at least the idea that I make very clear in my, again, it's Intro to Ethnic Studies. So the first time I did it, I had all these kind of theoretical ideas I wanted them to get. I wanted them to get racial formation theory, hegemony, Foucault, and like power, and all of that stuff. I've stripped all that down to just, if you can understand racial formation theory, Omi and Winer, right? I mean, Michael Omi, he's wherever we, you know, he's right over there, right? If we, that's where I start the first day, and it's very clearly, this is what I would have assigned you, this book, but I'm just going to march through what this means. And what we're going to do the rest of our course is really explore this one theoretical idea in detail. So that if you leave my summer Intro to Ethnic Studies course and you really understand what we mean by race, what we mean by culture, what we mean by gender, you know, all that stuff, and how what they mean by racial formation, then I'm good with the kind of theoretical stuff. So to answer your question, I've gone from my half dozen theories and scholarly arguments to let's just make sure they get the foundational idea, but really get it. So we kind of explore one theory throughout the entire 6 weeks.
And I think that also what you were just saying, you know, brought up for me was that speaks to the utility of how you are designing the course where you're using primarily, you know, primary texts. Because especially, you know, a lot of those articles that have, say, different but commensurable theoretical frameworks that you like, don't look commensurable necessarily to students.
Yeah.
And you'll have maybe like 5 or 10% of the class who are like, yes, I understand like this fits with this and like, et cetera, et cetera. But a lot of students are like, so so-and-so says this and so-and-so says this about this other thing, and are they related? And you're like, yes, and it's complicated, and
yeah.
then and that's like the difficulty of using the secondary materials. So it's I've learned to increasingly tread carefully.
Yeah, I have a question about this because I'm like just going through my whole syllabus in my head. I have a lot of secondary stuff because most of my stuff was films.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, okay, they can read maybe like 30 pages of analysis along with watching the film. But there's definitely some moments where they're also, probably where they're reading something, I'm going to cut out the secondary stuff and just give that to them. But my question is like, how do you feel about optional readings or giving them the possibility of like reading, like this, you know, the students that are maybe like on a higher level, more familiar, they can read it, but they don't, you know, they're not required to do so.
Provided no one will read it. But what I think is useful for it is they will hold on to that syllabus. And maybe down the road when they're doing their senior thesis or what have you,
yeah.
they will go back and use them.
Yeah.
But I think in the time crunch, and again, in summer, there are not students generally, in my experience, that I just wanted to stay in Berkeley and take one summer class, so I'm going to devote my whole 6 weeks. I mean, these are students that are working, doing internships,
yeah.
trying to get, so they're already don't have time to do everything that's required. So just in my experience, I like providing extra stuff. I always have the last slide of all of my kind of historical lectures is like my works cited.
Yeah.
It's like, here's all the cool stuff. Take 5 minutes, find the title that's interesting to you. Because this is what I just pulled from all of this to tell you this is what it was.
Yeah.
And so I kind of do it that way. That, like, write this stuff down if it's interesting. And you, there are a couple of students that are like, they will write stuff down. So, but yeah,
Yeah, I'd say it's more for you.
Yeah,
so that you don't have to jettison it. Yeah. If you need it to be on there as a suggested reading, then just do that.
Yeah.
And then you can be like, I'm going to reference this idea from this reading. It's there. It's up on B courses for you. Go for it. If you want to read it,
yeah.
it's all you. I'm gonna extract this one idea, and you can see why I wasn't just like, oh, well, they should read this, 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 and this. You have a reason that it's on there. And that if they want to explore it further, then they do that.
The other thing I would say about secondary readings, what I found, the reason I moved away from them, is students weren't actually equipped with the skills to know that you're reading for the argument. So what I would get in discussion was, oh, I didn't know this historical fact that they alluded to there. Right, so that what they actually were retaining from the secondary reading was the gaps in their historical knowledge about Vietnam, right? That was covered in some article, when that's not really the point of the article at all. And so that was more and more why I said, okay, well, let's actually just give them the trade press, like Nick Turst, Kill Anything That Moves sort of history book, right? They're like, because they'll read it and they'll be fascinated by that. And then we say, okay, now let's build on that with something else.
I have a related question to that. Probably skipping ahead to something you guys will cover, but so if you're not, I mean, I totally agree, even in the semester, I feel like many of my students are not equipped to read for argument, and so this is something that I incorporate into my teaching, like how to read for argument, etc. And I get why that wouldn't necessarily work in this context, but then how can you expect them to, let's say, write a paper with an argument if you can't, like, have the benefit of the entire semester constantly referring to how authors that you're reading are making arguments?
Mm-hmm. I'll just click ahead to it.
Yeah.
Okay. Right? Yeah.
Move on. Just a logistical question, because, I mean, this is related to this idea of, like, not trying to overload, like, a semester
yeah.
with, like, you know, a series of readings that you're going to dig into and work on and try to comprehend. How do you provide disseminate the readings that you do use and other materials that you do use? I mean, a lot of classes these days just do everything electronically on key courses. It sounds like for some students that might actually be a burden as opposed to a gift. Maybe is it better? Do you recommend doing good courses, PDFs, etc.? And a reader, how do you go about doing that yourself? I mean, all my books, I only like scan straight on my books, so I have all the underlining and stuff.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Really
so
old
like,
sometimes too.
Yeah.
Like, don't
yeah.
read that note.
Some of my students are not necessarily my underlining.
Exactly. So you know.
No, I do a reader and B courses typically because you'll, in my experience, it's always been maybe 25-30% of students want that physical thing to underline in, etc. Yeah, I mean, scanning a library copy, there are other available resources for thing for books that are out there. Obviously, scholarly articles, it's tough because, I mean, it's easy to get them, and it's tough to expect the, you know, that that kind of heavy lifting necessarily. So if you're doing primary sources, I mean, I'm sure you've encountered this, a lot of those books are dirt cheap.
Yeah.
Also,
I also order them through a local, I don't submit an order with the bookstore, so I do an order with a local bookstore that I like.
Yeah.
So they have the books, and I encourage students to buy them there and support one of the last remaining children in Berkeley. So, yeah, what I've done though is I typically put readings when I do readings on B courses and say, if you want, I encourage you all to have a hard copy, so just print them out.
Yeah. I'll do a B courses that's, I use the modules, but I don't really use them the way they're designed necessarily, where there's, you have to pass this quiz in order to access the rest of the module. But I just use it as a sort of visual organizer for the syllabus. And at the bottom is where I dump things that are interesting. I'm gonna always be updating this segment of the modules, and it becomes, you know, like on the screen, it becomes that long because it's like a link to an interesting article in, you know, from Huffington Post, and a link to a data resource, and a link to, and you know, like a few ebooks from, you know, my hard drive. It's like, if you want to know more about this, you read one chapter of it, here's the whole book, you know, that kind of, that method, which again, getting back to like, it's more for you that you like gave them that, and a few people will actually seek it out, but it's mostly to make you, it makes me feel like I'm giving them, I'm like surrounding them with information, and sort of like whichever direction that, this is not a well worked out metaphor, but it's like whatever direction they walk in, they'll hit something that's useful.
To your question though about how are we building skills on developing arguments if they're not reading kind of argument,
yeah,
like prose. And so I think for me, the way that I address that in summers is very different than in semesters.
Yeah.
In semesters, there is,
right.
We do, how do we, you know, underline the central question, we do all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
In summers, I do much more kind of modeling in the discussion early on,
mm-hmm.
Right, where those first couple weeks, we're putting this all together, where we actually, the first week or two before they're actually submitting writing to me,
yeah,
I sort of conclude the discussion. I take the last 30 minutes of the discussion and say, okay, so based on what we've said, if we were to say, create an outline for a paper about this, the kind of central question that I put on the syllabus, and then we diagram what would be an argument, and we kind of refine it, and what would be our pieces of evidence, how would we draw something from the film, how would we draw something from the novel, the lecture, and then we actually, and actually kind of make outlines collectively on board once or twice, so that then week three, it's okay, now you need to come in to the discussion section with a 5-page paper where you've done all this and you've executed.
Yeah. Okay.
So yeah, I mean, you don't get as much of the kind of hands-on that, but I find that modeling it works okay.
Yeah,
that, yeah, to say that, well, what, you know,
yeah,
that there is an argument in a novel. It's not outlined as ultimately,
yeah,
I argue, but there is an argument. So what are they actually trying to say? What's the movie?
And also, like, what arguments can we,
exactly,
make about?
Exactly.
Like, what can,
yeah,
we say that is an argument?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've done a similar thing where, you know, break them up in groups, and there's sort of like, here, you're mapping this argument. You know, what's the argument? What are the pieces of evidence? And I came upon this because I was asking them to write papers utilizing, and this is how it was on the syllabus, utilizing concepts. And the notion of a concept was incredibly slippery for them. It's like, is it a big idea or a theory, or is it like, and they weren't kind of getting that mezzo level that I think we've all sort of like kind of smashed our brains into just automatically going to that. And it's like, we know where we know that sort of like hierarchical structure when we see it. And I've encountered enough students who were sort of like, everything was on this one plane, and doing that kind of an exercise in class where they're like kind of in teams, like, this is, let's do this, like, we are diagramming this.
Yeah.
I thought this was really helpful. To the issue of sort of designing other kinds of assignments, you know, you were saying a final paper, for instance. I've shied away from that. I've done typically response papers and given them a lot of latitude in terms of when they do them. So some students, you know, it's like you have to respond to, say, eight readings, for instance, or six readings, or something like that. You know, whatever seems reasonable. And they can do them, you have to turn it in the day that you read it, right? Of the day that it was in the syllabus. And so you can leave it all to the end and do a blitz, or you can space it out, etc. And then I've complemented that, and I think this is where we differ just in terms of subject material, is I actually had options. I had students could do, because it's an urban geography course. We have cities all around us, you know, and a lot of students, especially international students, are going to be like staying at international house, you know, and you won't be forced to leave campus if you don't push them necessarily. So I had a 12-photo photo essay on a theme was an option that they could do. I had doing a field trip on, say, in groups on two or so of an inventory of bus lines, of AC transit bus lines that I gave them, and sort of like, this is a vehicle for you to understand the city. And if they wanted to sit inside and read a book, or sit in the sun and read a book, that was an option, you know, like a book review was an option as well. So creating options and things that get them out of the classroom, and students who don't feel very confident in their argumentation in English, or just in their argumentation period, but they can take a bunch of photographs and kind of stitch them together and attach something that they're seeing in this photograph to something that we discussed in class or some idea of reading was very helpful for me. And I had students do really brilliant work. Like, they were like, these areas are so different, and there's a highway between them. And we took one bus, we took the one, and we took the 57 the other way, and it was like different worlds. And this relates to that reading. And I was like, I got goosebumps when they presented it, because I was like, this is what you're doing, this is what you need to do. Like, you don't need to parrot someone's theory. This is fantastic work. So again, I think that's a little bit different for you.
Yeah, my assignments are a lot less creative. I think I do usually three short response papers, 3 to 4 pages. And they have to do one on a book, one on a movie, and then a third one of their choice. That's all the written assignments. So if they're around 4 pages, then that's, they're doing
okay.
About 12 pages of writing. That's as opposed to, what, 15 to 18 in a semester. So that's kind of one of the things that they're just not going to write 20 pages.
Yeah.
And then I do a final exam.
You do?
Yeah.
I also.
That was my next question.
Yeah, I do a final exam. I let them know exactly the kinds of questions, kind of, because I found the summer midterm to me is not a good idea.
I wasn't sure about that, but at some
the,
people,
like week three,
hey, nice to meet you,
you just met me, but what do you know? And so I think that just, but then for me, then having a final paper and final exam, it just put way too much at the end of the semester. Students really didn't
right.
kind of know what they
sure,
were. And so,
yeah.
So I do papers,
okay.
I space them throughout, and you just they get to choose where they show up the day we discuss a class. I also find that, and with their paper ready, I also find that helps class discussion because
yeah,
you have a half dozen sort of experts that have been thinking about the book much more,
yeah.
or the assignment much more critically than everyone else, so they kind of can get stuff started. So.
Could you say more about the exam? Is it more identification or more open-ended mix?
Yeah, so the way I do all of my exams is I do a combination of IDs, short answers, and an essay. My essay questions are always, they're basically academic ways of writing what did you learn? Choose 3 tag, you know, but so the one in my Intro to Ethnic Studies class is just this prompt about you know, Omi and Wine define racial formation as this kind of process, this is what we should discuss how using three different historical episodes, how, it's basically just saying, show me what you've learned here. The IDs are always drawn from lectures, so they're key terms from lectures, redlining, you know, executive order, you know, just kind of historic ideas from the lecture. And then the short, I have a kind of two short essays, which are like kind of like a two paragraph response, and those are drawn exclusively from readings. So that way it's lecture, reading, putting them together in the essay. And that's what my exams look like.
And then this is just a practical question. Do we have an exam date, or do you have to use like your last day of class?
It's
do summer
day.
Classes,
last
yeah,
day of class.
Day. Summer classes don't have
yeah.
another.
It's the last day of class.
I do very image heavy lectures also. So one of the things, and I blatantly steal from Paul Groth all the time, and you know, he just retired in geography and architecture, and is a fantastic teacher and has some an absurd inventory of something like 35,000 images from 1970 to present that he took, right? But I do image comparisons as well, which again is it's a fun way of, and I do this actually in all my classes, but especially in an American cultures course, and you know, showing kind of juxtaposing, maybe you juxtapose these images in lectures or not, but they've seen them before and there's a reason that they're together on the screen, and I think it kind of, you know, jump starts, gets people thinking in a little bit of a different way, and that's been, I think, useful for me, because you don't have to, you know, claw something out from the recesses of your brain. There's something to say right there, and maybe you do a really good job of relating them, and maybe you do an okay job of relating them. But it's been very useful for me in final exams.
Another thing I would highly recommend for final exams, given just sort of the blitz of the 6 weeks, is having choice.
Mm-hmm.
So I always
yeah.
have choice. So if I have IDs, I'll say answer 5 of 7
right.
IDs. If I have short essays, it'll be answer 2 of 3. Right? The idea that, you know, especially with how fast we've moved, you know, to give students the flexibility to show you what they've learned, as opposed to, you know, that they just got stuck on the one question, you know, and then it ends up really kind of playing a significant penalty in their final grade. So I like giving a lot of choice to just say, you're going to have as many opportunities as you can to demonstrate that you've been engaged, you've done the reading, and you've really thought critically about a lot of this stuff. And if you just happen to have forgot those, you know, whatever, that one thing from that one lecture, it's fine. Just choose something else and show. So that doesn't mean I say, here's 20 IDs, pick whatever 5 you want. But I usually do choose 5 of 8. And then what I do is I have, I kind of, if I do 8, I'll have like tiers where there's a couple very easy ones that should be off. If you were conscious and in class, that should be obvious. I have a couple sort of semi-difficult, you know, kind of meet, and then a few challenging ones so that every student has to, if they're doing 5, they have to answer at least one really challenging one, right? And that's just thinking about how the grades will sort of break down.
Just because we're gonna have
yeah,
lunch
sure.
in just a second, but this does also relate, which is how much time should you expect to spend? And I think, especially if it's the first one you taught more than you think, obviously creating strategies so that you don't have, say, an hour and a half of lecturing every single day, which it'll consume your whole life if you let it. It's a very good idea. And then also, you know, it is tough, but not treating it like you're sort of your first stab at being, you know, you are teaching your own course. Approaching it a little bit more like you're teaching this particular kind of sort of intensive practicum or something like that, rather than a semester-length course that you're smashing in, where like you have in your mind the people who you GSI'd for, who, you know, it's like the so-and-so show, and they're just recalling things from memory because they've done this for 25 years. That's not how it's going to go if you want to have any time outside of doing this.
Yeah, I do. It's a lot the first time through.
Yeah.
I'm a script person. I find myself, I want any chance at coherence, I need to do what I would say. And so, man, that first batch, and so as a result, every time I leave every lecture, like, oh, there's so much different stuff I could do that would be so much better. But I just don't change it because that's the script and it works, and it's like, it's sort of okay. A 2 hour, if you're gonna do like a one long lecture a week, a 2 hour script is a very long document.
Yeah.
It's a very long document. And if you print it bigger so that you can read it easier, it's feels like you're walking around with your dissertation, but it's just, you know, it's just Monday.
Yeah. And I'd also say that do try to teach the same class twice. I mean, even if it was sort of like, I'd rather teach this other thing, try to get some of the work that you did for this, try to kind of amortize that over a couple of times, because it does really help. I left the first one, basically as soon as I printed out the syllabus, I was like, oh, I want to do all these different things. And you just kind of have to go with it when you sort of incorporate that for next time.
And I think doing a summer class, at least for me, and I think in part because it was summer and in part because it's an intro class, that for me, my Race in California class has become, individual weeks have become their own classes. So I do a class on the suburbs, and that's because we do 1 week in Race in California about race and housing inequality, right? So then that 1 week became a whole class that I do in the fall. We do a week on the new right, the rise of modern conservatism in Orange County, California. That became a class that's the 1970s, the decade nothing happened, which is Goldwater to Reagan, right? Like, so it's like all of these kind of individual, you end up investing so much in doing your sort of 1 2-hour lecture. And part of, I think, the productive way, as opposed to saying, well, I need to redo everything and create all this new work for myself next summer, is to say, well, this works as an intro lecture, but this creates all sorts of ideas of what I could do in sort of a semester.
Yeah.
Right? Or that rather than cramming everything you want them to read for that one summer week, to think, well, if I added twice or three times as much, then I'm starting to have a semester, its own class. And so that's been some of the way that I've managed the frustration of just how much I've had to cut down, is, well, these are just sort of ideas that we're planning into, we're kind of introducing students to material every week. And the hope is that down the road, these will be sort of things that pique their interest that they'll explore further in a semester, you know.
Any other questions before? I mean, obviously, we'll all be in the room. We can talk during lunch. We're going to do, I guess, about 30 minutes for lunch. You know, keep eating while the next session happens. But yeah, if there aren't any other burning questions for, say, what's up here right now, I think we'll break for lunch for about 30 minutes. Okay, thanks, guys.
All right, so everybody's got Justin. That's okay. You can.
Sarah had to leave, so.
Okay. So we're going to take a look a little bit more about the history, as John had said about the American cultural environment. I think everybody in the room, it was their first time teaching an American cultural class. Is that right? Okay, great. So there's actually a pretty interesting history of where this requirement comes from. And I've actually prepared a video that's going to talk about where it comes from and what it has sort of turned into today.
I want to start in thinking about American cultures and why it's so important to think back to that time, because there really is a very direct connection between the anti-apartheid movement and the birth of American cultures. And there was this spark ignited in South Africa when the government decided to allow so-called Indians and coloreds to participate in elections for the first time, a reform that they thought would ease some of the political pressure, but instead had the opposite effect and gave birth to the United Democratic Front and for the first time in many years, open political protest in the country. So once again, the government was forced, or felt forced, to respond with violence against these protests, which brought South Africa back on all the news. And so that then led to first longshore workers here in San Francisco refusing to unload cargo from a South African ship, led to TransAfrica starting a series of protests with the Congressional Black Caucus at the South African Embassy, and started a movement across the country that particularly took hold on college campuses and Berkeley especially. To be associated with a movement that actually succeeded was really unusual, but still highly significant. And because of the momentum that we'd built, and we were really feeling our oats, we said, well, now, if we could do that, we could do more. We can begin to dismantle some of the racial barriers here on the campus. And so we started thinking about the curriculum and looking at the faculty. And the fact was that although Berkeley had been one of the first campuses to create an ethnic studies program because of student protest, it had become a place where ethnic studies was totally marginalized and where there were very, very few faculty of color anywhere else at the university. And we said, this has got to be our issue. For those of us who were students on the campus, we've got to make sure that we desegregate the campus, desegregate the curriculum. Although it was a compromise, it was a compromise that I think actually did something profoundly significant on the campus. Now, Ron Choi, who's here, was played a critical role in this, and Troy Duster, a mentor of mine, also played a very important role, because what they did was they said, what we're going to do is create a requirement that could be offered anywhere on the campus. And we'll establish criteria that these courses need to meet, a comparative criteria. Right, so that you're not just learning about an experience, you're learning about multiple ethnic and cultural experiences in these courses. And we're going to give faculty resources to develop these courses, and we're going to bring faculty together to talk about their work, something that was unheard of at UC, that the faculty would actually talk about teaching. Right? You know, think about that.
We are proud of where American Cultures is today. This past year, American Cultures courses in engineering, peace and conflict studies, ethnic studies, legal studies, architecture, anthropology, and public health all worked with community organizations, building student and faculty research into the developing fights for environmental justice, prison abolition, indigenous movements, the fight for K-12 education, and the arts and social justice.
I think different universities are experimenting with different models of engaged scholarship. But I think what's unique about the Berkeley approach is the twinning of American cultures and engaged scholarship. Because what it does is to make questions of race, class, gender, and other inequalities central to engaged scholarship. So the way I like to think about it is that engaged scholarship becomes a very intimate confrontation with those lived experiences of race, class, and gender.
I feel like with the community engaged scholarship, right, it makes it theoretical practical. And my critique of education is that we learn all these theories, we learn about all these people, but how is that addressing my day-to-day life? I don't believe that education or the knowledge that we're learning about is just for our brains and then we just go ahead and make a whole bunch of money. It's about like what can we do for our society and how can we help out those around us and the community that in communities in which we come from. And I think community engaged scholarship does exactly that. And it makes like life for these people real. If you never lived this experience, the only way for you to really know about it is to actually be embedded and immersed in that experience. And that's what engaged scholarship does, in my opinion, that's what it does for me.
But I think in the final analysis, we're talking about teaching. We're talking about making it possible for our students to prepare for the 21st century by having the opportunity to participate in community engagement and to know firsthand what their issues are and not just take a second hand or accept at face value what a particular textbook says or by some social scientist who was an expert in the area.
Given to you when you're applying, on this video about this history. So that's, it's something that we're certainly working on, as well as, just where AC exists these days. And so I would encourage you all to, look a lot more closely into some of these projects. The way that ACES works is, so if you want to have an ACES course, we do offer grants in order for you to develop a community partnership. And there are plenty of partners to choose from. We partnered with everybody from the, there's a Paiute tribe over in the Owens Valley, in Bishop as well as in Big Pine. And they have really worked with a faculty member by the name of Patricia Stehlin in her class, Researching Water in the West, which is really to expose a narrative of how the LA Water District has been stealing the water from the Owens Valley for almost 100 years now. And that doesn't get told. I mean, you hear about the water stories between Northern California and Southern California, but there are these ancient irrigation canals that have existed for hundreds, I think thousands of years, and the LA Water District has really come in and dried those out. And for the longest time, there was no way to prove that, right? Because it wasn't, that specific tribe didn't have a written history, it had more of an oral history, but you could certainly walk and see those irrigation canals. Well, one day, one of the tribal elders actually comes to the campus, and he meets with this faculty member for a completely different issue. But lo and behold, they find these notebooks in the Bancroft, which were actually produced by Arthur Kroeber graduate students and the Owens Valley Paiute. And they actually had mapped out a lot of these irrigation canals years before the aqueducts were built in LA. And so that is like your proof that these canals have existed, the LA Water District has been stealing the water. And so they bring this to the Supreme Court. And really this is a clear example of a narrative that has not existed at all. And for the longest time, I think the closest reference was there's a book called Cadillac Desert, which does talk about the Paiute, I think like a paragraph or a sentence or two, and it gets it completely wrong. They learn how to do their canals from the Spanish, when in reality, there's proof that they had developed them for thousands of years. And in this class, there was a student by the name of Jenna Cavell, who actually befriended the elder, who's Harry Williams, and she actually went to live on the reservation for about 3 years through the Stronach Prize, and she developed a short film called Maya, which is the story of how the LA Water District has actually stolen. How are we doing on time?
We're doing good. I think maybe want to bring it back to discussion, go through a little bit of the slides. How long is this?
3 minutes.
Oh yeah, that's fine.
Okay. So we can see the trailer.
I don't know this episode.
Okay, great. So this is the award-winning trailer. This was just shown at the Red Nation Film Festival, and it won Best Short Documentary back in November. So.
Fifty years ago, my people were forcefully taken from this land.
There was a massacre that took place here.
We understand that the issue is the land, the issue is the earth,
tens of thousands of years, there's evidence of humanity being here. Miles and miles of ancient irrigation systems were dug. That's what they did. And we found them today. Legally today, that might be binding in court. Big dream for LA was to steal the water out of here. They actually stole it. They lied, cheated, and stole.
It was really a secret entering into the valley. It devastated our culture.
Now problems we should note, including poor air quality in the Owens Valley as the Owens Lake dried up, creating dust clouds.
We've had a hard time adjusting.
We were considered wards of the state.
We became reliant on others because that was the system they wanted to see happen.
Drought does accentuate conflicts between the urban and rural parts of the state.
And I stand here in 2013, and the water rights issue has not been resolved.
And it's affecting the reservation. It's affecting the water table. It's affecting the vegetation on the reservation.
It's going to be a matter of the courts.
You need to stand up for your rights.
I'd go straight after the president. Where are you at?
One example of, this is an example of something that you know, with, you know, of course seeds take a while to plant. She didn't develop this film in the class. She's now a master's student over at USC, but you know, the relationship certainly started at during the college writing 5150 AC course, and there are, so that's sort of a standout example of something that is grown over the years. There's also an interactive website that was created in the public health course that we offer. And this is called Station to Station, looking at health inequities across the park. And so you just kind of go through it, look at each station. It's a lot. Which part of station you live could make a difference, a decade of difference in how long you live. And so that was looking at places like Richmond.
Yeah, approaching Richmond, the final stop of the track, please take a moment, look around, make sure you have all of your phones.
Which had one of the lowest life expectancies. And they talk about, you know, what those health inequalities are at Richmond. Heart disease, income, and of course there's interviews here. And 12th Street, Oakland, had the lowest life expectancy, which is right near Chinatown. And Walnut Creek had the highest, over a decade of difference. When we look at the cancer rate, and we look at the education, one example of Wikipedia assignments. We do offer Wikipedia workshops on how to create Wikipedia pages as classroom assignments. Were you all aware that you can make Wikipedia classroom assignments? So this was really an initiative that that sort of began with Victoria, the director of AC. She knew a Wikipedia geek who really knew how to create Wikipedia pages. problem used to be if you wanted to create a Wikipedia page, you had to know how to do your citations, you had to know how to do the formatting, and if you didn't, they would quickly take it down. And so she happened to know a geek who was in her class and was part of that community and helped her create the first Wikipedia pages on the prison industrial complex, alternatives to incarceration. Most recently, we had some Wikipedia pages created for integrated biology. Since that time, you no longer need a geek. The Wikipedia Education Foundation actually created these modules in which you can learn how to have Wikipedia pages as classroom assignments in a very streamlined way, so that you know how to do your citations, and the pages are they're great. They're getting thousands of hits. When this went up, it was one of the most popular pages, and it was edited about 10 times in the entire time that went up, and the average Wikipedia page is edited about at least 100 times. So these are, very well-received pages, like quality pages that, need very little editing, and, that was really thanks to an initiative that Victoria had. And now the Wikipedia Foundation has just made, nationwide, if instructors want to have that as a classroom assignment. And if you want to learn more about that, please contact us, and we'd be happy to put you in touch with folks at Wikipedia. I don't want to take up a whole lot more time. We do. AC has grown, as the video said, in not just in the humanities. We do have one course in engineering called the Engineering, Environment, and Society. We do have an integrated biology ACES course, which as I said, does Wikipedia pages, and they're about to launch the first ACES course this fall. And then there's also a more local Wikipedia website called Shaping SF, and in a class called the History of Social Movements, the Politics of Memory, the students can develop these pages, which talk about histories in SF, which are usually not spoken about, which are usually forgotten, and that includes the history of the Ohlone and the shell mount that was over in Emeryville. I don't know if you folks are familiar with where IKEA is. They completely demolished the shell mount that was there, and the developers made sort of a faux shell mount that was very disrespectful to the Ohlone. Every year they're there, basically telling folks don't shop here, especially during like Black Friday. And you can read about those histories on these pages which students have created. The last one I'll say, I'll put out there, is also immigration. In Victoria's class, they did create these really cool DACA posters. And it basically walks you through the entire process of how to apply to DACA. And as I said, because it really is putting that theory to practice, working with communities, they were able to get 30 undocumented immigrants approved for DACA this year, in this semester in her class. And this is all about how to apply. It's pretty cool. The students created this. I mean, the students, they just create really amazing stuff. And don't have that expectation in the 6-week summer course. But, if this is something that you're thinking about down the line, we'd love to hear from you, and please feel free to explore some of these examples, both English and Spanish.
All right, so we've got about, say, 20 minutes maybe to go over some more AC-specific questions, especially having to do with sort of teaching to racial justice, teaching social justice issues, especially in sort of the current moment in university in the United States, et cetera. And I saw that was something that people specifically wanted to talk about. But one of the questions was sort of like how to, say, respectfully and thoroughly cover that requirement of, three groups without it being a kind of like watered down diversity type of analysis. I don't know. Do you want to?
Yeah, I think.
Do you want to speak to that?
This is actually the second half and probably the more important half of why especially in AC courses in the summer, I assign exclusively primary readings. I think it's one of the key ways to allow different experiences and different voices to enter the classroom, that when you're dealing with sort of secondary readings, it just is sort of abstracted too much. And you know, you saw the video about the history of AC, and so when Ethnic Studies asked me to teach Ethnic Studies 10 AC, my first question was like, are you sure, right, that you want this cisgendered, white, straight male teaching Intro to Ethnic Studies? And although my PhD is in African American Studies and I consider myself sort of, you know, very well informed, I also am sensitive to the fact that of what AC meant and what the Ethnic Studies department has meant. And so that sort of was a weird thing to me to get that invitation. And to be quite honest, I've taught Ethnic Studies 10 AC both in the semesters and in the summer. And I did it for like 200 students in the fall a year and a half ago. And of those 200 students, there were about three or four evaluations that just said, this straight white dude should not be teaching Intro to Ethnic Studies. And I, you know, I understand that you're balancing sort of intellectual requirements of a course with the sort of social and political realities of a campus in which there was very little diversity among the faculty. There were very few faculty members of color. And one would expect there to be a higher likelihood of to find a faculty member of color in Ethnic Studies. So I get that, right? So for me, one of the ways to avoid kind of reproducing the sort of white male heteronormativity of the academy is that in everything you read, you're going to get stuff that challenges that, right? That the scholarship I'm lecturing about is coming out of African American Studies and Ethnic Studies on the one hand, but also the voices that we get in the novels, in the films, what have you, that it's speaking to different sorts of experiences. And that's my primary way of dealing with kind of how do you really address this requirement in a really kind of, you know, in spirit with what we're supposed to be doing. I think the other thing is that is also for me why my Ethnic Studies AC course is about California, because California gives you a much more sort of cosmopolitan state in which the sort of history of multiple racial groups are very much entangled with one another. So it's difficult to go through California history and to talk about World War II in California without dealing with Japanese Americans as well as African Americans as well as Latinos. So so that became a way where I think I wouldn't have thought, oh, I'm going to do an AC class about the Jim Crow South, right? Not that there isn't sort of texture there, but it's not, you know, California's sort of unique in that regard. So this sort of question very much informed choosing the topic of the course that I chose, and is really the most, the sort of intellectual reason behind what I've been kind of saying all morning, is that I only assign primary readings, because I want, that to me seems to be the best way to get more voices sort of at the front of the class, kind of doing some of the lecture.
Yeah, I mean, I'm in the sort of the same, a similar subject position to Justin, although I think a lot of people go into the urban experience 70 AC not thinking of it primarily as an AC course, maybe. That's been my experience in the summer. I don't know what it's. Don't know what it's like during the main semester. I don't teach it, although it's now. I may be teaching it in the main semester offering in the spring. Yeah, it's a, because I don't use quite as many primary texts. It's a little bit different. And one of the things, say, if you're teaching a sort of sociological, kind of like social history or like socio-spatial history, the way I do it is like also the question of like how to make it not just kind of like an inventory of injuries, you know, like you could do that with the sociology of education class very easily, where it's sort of, it's obviously addressing the requirement and obviously sort of implicating forces that deserve to be implicated, but without a lot of nuance about like that more relational dimension. Yeah. So to bring that in, I have done a lot of a lot more primary sources, especially for more recent California history films, or for more recent urban history, and actually, again, kind of focusing in more on California because it is such a rich kind of like text in and of itself. Also not making it sort of like, you know, one day on this group, one day on this group. A lot of what I did, you know, I felt like it was a big victory when I had a student who was Armenian and had never considered the idea that he wasn't white, and it was only actually reading about like when Irish people weren't considered white like 100 or so years ago, or more recently depending on what you're drawing from, it's that was like allowed him to sort of look with new eyes on his own experience. So it also was like kind of like breaking open that question of race, and for me, race and space, and looking at them as these totally entangled processes. And again, talking about World War II, it's like you can't do anything without doing kind of everything.
Right. Yeah, and I think just a couple of things on that it's, you know, I take terms very seriously, and so this is an American culture's requirement. And I think that any class satisfying the AC requirement has to take very seriously and really interrogate what do we mean by America, and what do different ideas about what is included or not included or silenced by America, what work does that do? As well as culture, right? This site in which meaning is made, experiences are represented, oppression is challenged, right? But that's very much sort of the work of culture. And so to me, some of it is being very deliberate in we are looking at America and what that means, and the kind of power dynamics in that, and we're looking at culture and what that means in terms of remaking ideas about America, but also challenging those ideas. And that again all kind of leads back to primary text. I think the other kind of two quick things that I would say is I have this sort of little rant that I like to get in whenever I can, and this is a good place to do it. One way to do this strictly, please don't ever use the word Caucasian in your class. I mean, I'm assuming you wouldn't do that, but Caucasian is not accurate. People who consider themselves Caucasian are not Caucasian, they're white, right? I'm sure as you all know, the Caucasus Mountains are in Eastern Europe, they go in the Republic of Georgia. So anyone who is British or German or whatever, they are not Caucasian.
This is a great viral video.
I was just the term you're looking for is white. In addition to, you know, we all know that you know, the term Caucasian comes up in the 1970s as a deliberate way to kind of undermine challenges to white supremacy, right? So I think especially, I mean, I cringe when I hear about like courses on race, and then you see like, oh, we're talking about Caucasians, and it's like, oh, well, you know, that's not weird. Unless you're actually dealing with sort of ethnic people from the Republic of Georgia, then okay. But and the other thing I think about this too is I think to a point John mentioned, like you don't want to just give this sort of inventory of struggle that, you know, I have a colleague who teaches a very popular AC course, it's African American Studies 27 AC, and the title forever, because it's been around forever, is Lives of Struggle. And his whole first lecture is, this is the dumbest course title on campus. And he's like, because, you know, people of color, all they do is struggle, right? They don't ever laugh, they don't ever, you know, have any fun, it's just struggle all the time. And so so his whole kind of first lecture is, I deliberately keep the course title that he inherited, you know, that he inherited in there, as a way to start the process of thinking in a truly sort of complex, dynamic, and humane way about, we're talking about people's lives, that although struggle and oppression is a key feature of that, it is not the entirety of what it means to be racialized outside the boundaries of whiteness in the United States. And so some of it for me is that you're not just giving this sort of catalog of injury, that you're really showing what these sort of experiences and all, as much kind of texture as you can, you know, in there.
I think that links to this next question, which is sort of like, how do you set learning expectations? And specifically, in the summer course, we've already talked about a lot of students who aren't gonna come in maybe with a lot of that tacit knowledge about the United States. I like to tell this story. My friend had friends visiting from Sweden, and they rented a movie, and it's just kind of a random choice, but he selected Bamboozled. And they literally had no idea what the movie was about. Like, none of the tacit knowledge that we all, as like, you know, people who are familiar with the Americas even bring to that question of representation, et cetera? I mean, if you don't know the film, it's a Spike Lee film that's about a parody minstrel show that becomes an incredibly popular show on television. And it was, they didn't have any of the tacit knowledge kinds of tools for this. And so especially like learning expectations are really interesting in at least they have been really interesting for me in this context, because people bring in a lot of like strange kind of things that they've latched onto about like the particular forms of racialization within the United States, or just, and a lot of it is sort of, you know, talking to them about the linguistic implications of terms that have sort of filtered out to their, you know, to their experience of like, you know, referring to things as ghetto, because it's like a general kind of term that has traveled their way and is sort of like detached from like the really the specific connotations and this kind of like debates and struggles over that term. So a lot of the, at least for me, the learning expectations is sort of like there's a grammar to this world that is totally not intuitive, because the thing I like to talk about is in America, it's actually really, it's tried to become a template for a lot of places, but it's an incredibly bizarre place that is not intuitive, that there's not like sort of stable whole things that you can gather up in one term. So kind of like keeping them unsettled has actually been really useful, even though it might not be satisfying for them, because they're sort of like, well, what is the answer? And there kind of isn't one.
I think it's a really good place to start. My first day lecture in the, you know, after giving up the syllabus is about defining our key terms. So what do we mean by race? What do we mean by gender? What do we mean by sexuality? I use the example of ghetto, right, as a term that is racialized without explicitly being racialized. And I use the example of, you would never go pick up a date and say, "Ma, you look so ghetto this evening. Are you ready to go?" That it's never a compliment, right? And I use kind of really kind of practical examples. I do heteronormativity, and I play that Meghan Trainor song all about that bass, because the hook in that is, you know, my mama told me, don't worry about your size, boys like a little more booty to hold at night. And so I said, like, on the one hand, it's supposed to be this sort of anthem challenging the ways in which our society sets very sort of limited, very skinny expectations on women and their bodies in order to be desirable. But on the other hand, it's remaking this idea that to be a woman is ultimately to be desired by a man. So, but it's all this song saying is, don't worry, men like women that are a little bit bigger. Right, so like that's what heteronormativity is that the hetero norm is still upheld, even as it's seemingly being challenged. So, day one, really basic stuff that I take on, like how does race and these ideas play out, and it's sort of a light way to get started, right, to set up this sort of grammar. I have a list of like, these are terms we are going to use when we talk about different racial groups. These are accepted ways to talk about different racial groups. These are things we are not going to, you know, words we are not going to use. This is why. So some of that is distinguishing between Chicano and Latino. In my classes, I don't use Hispanic because that's just this sort of census term that I, you know. So it's just, you know, going through that. I would say with undergraduates that you'd see, you wouldn't need to clarify this, but I always clarify, people of color, okay. Colored people, not okay. Right, that I didn't do that at first, and right away it was just getting thrown around like, hey, stop, you know. Yeah. So I think that especially as they're going to be talking about, you know, race, gender, all these kind of different things, that you want to just kind of introduce them. What are the terms we're going to be using? How am I using them? What terms am I using sort of interchangeably and not? And what terms did you feel like you should, you know, that I want you all to use when we're talking? So.
Yeah, there was one other thing. I think maybe it actually gets to this point as well, the value of creative work. You know, I talked a lot about the field trips that they're not, I don't lead them. There's not enough time. But I, it's sort of, that's that final project, one of the options for a final project, and it introduces some of the possibilities and pitfalls, right, where people are sort of like, well, this is like a bad neighborhood, because they've sort of absorbed the visual markers of what counts as a bad neighborhood. At the same time, or like, I had a student who was like, I'd never ridden the bus, basically, before I took this class. And sort of like, because it's actually, that's a really interesting moment to be like, this is like a racialized form of movement, or it's like raced and classed all kind of together. But you do get into people, say, in my experience, students bringing in tacit knowledge in a kind of negative sense of like sort of offhanded impressions, and that's where like the time management becomes really hard, because you could go off on an evaluation on someone's work when you're like grading a paper and spend a lot of time being like, here's why, like, you know, this isn't like part of our lingua franca in this class, for instance. And that becomes really challenging. But another thing that's been really interesting for me is getting students who were thinking about things comparatively. So students who were from Malaysia or Singapore or Japan, who were trying to start building these kind of comparisons between some really difficult to compare type of urban scenarios. And so that was another way to bring in kind of the questions of the AC requirement, at least for me, because it was sort of like, you know, there's a lot to know to really have a fluid grasp of racialization, but thinking of both where you come from and where you are and what you're learning about as kind of equally strange can be a productive way to start thinking through these issues.
Yeah. I just the way my course is structured, I don't have a lot of creative work in there, but I think that it's great. I think what you do is fantastic. Because I do think that, you know, an AC class is a good space to think about, you know, more creative ideas and stuff.
Yeah. Another question, I mean, and this also, we kind of got on this question, you know, how do I deal with difficult or sensitive discussions in the classroom? And on the one hand, the idea is to have difficult and sensitive discussions, but without making it a kind of make or break, like use the wrong term, you're out, you're, you know, that kind of thing. I don't know, if you had some things to say about this particular one, I think.
Yeah, I think, you know, this raises the whole question about things like trigger warnings and things like that. I tend to give sort of a day one disclaimer that there's going to be a wide range of stuff that we're going to deal with, and just sort of leave it at that. You know, I'm sort of evolving on the trigger warning thing. I'm kind of going from very hostile to them to being more open to them. Because I feel like that we're supposed to deal with difficult and sensitive. I mean, that's the nature of learning. And but I had an experience with a student in a non-AC class in the fall where it wasn't that incident that I think this student just didn't read, right? So then we were in class talking and it was a difficult conversation, so the student had to leave, right? And then a friend of this student said, you know, kind of asked me that in the future I should maybe give a disclaimer about what we were going to be talking about, and I said, well, there kind of is, because it's on the syllabus that we're talking about. That we're talking about this reading today, and if you read it, you knew what it was about, and you were more than willing to send me an email saying, I'm uncomfortable, this was a very difficult reading, I don't think I can sit in class. So, and I would be totally supportive of that. So you can't expect me to give disclaimers on the, in case anyone isn't prepared, here's where we're going. But it also made me feel like this was a student that, you know, I came to find out was having some sort of difficult issues, and the reason they were behind was not a sort of lack of interest in the class, but just had fallen behind. And so that made me think that maybe there should be a little more foregrounding. I don't know that I could justify every week saying like, hey, here's the things that are, but I think what I do is just right at the outset. I talk about, we're dealing with a lot of stuff week to week, and it's going to be challenging. If you have issues, please let me know. I can communicate those. If you think it's going to be a day that it's just difficult for you to be in class I'm willing to talk about that. But also, we are going to be talking about things like you know, racism and privilege and white supremacy, and so part of that is a necessary endeavor in acquiring the knowledge we're trying to acquire, and that's you know, one of my big learning objectives for my ethnic studies class is that we're thinking of the history of California through the lens of white supremacy, and white supremacy not as people in white sheets and hoods, but as the ways in which opportunities and resources and value is placed on certain lives and not others, and so that becomes sort of like the operating kind of lens through which we look at the history of California. And, you know, there are different sort of, there are ways in which I think that's more or less confrontational. But yeah, I think like you said, that we're debating ideas, we're not, you know, denigrating individuals for bringing ideas that we might find worthy of criticism.
Yeah, I mean, just in my experience, I think I've had somewhat fewer of these conversations in class. I mean, I welcome them, but in the context, I think that, you know, some of the trigger warning debates have become overheated, maybe, especially in the sort of the popular press. But I do think, I mean, it's speaks to what we're trying to do in class, which is questions of power, sort of like who is able to kind of shield themselves on a daily basis from things that they don't like to think about, and who's kind of confronted with them. And I had a friend who was teaching history of city planning through the lens of Ferguson last summer, which sounded like an amazing class, and sort of, you know, She sent me an email and sort of like, how do you feel about using imagery from a lynching? And on the one hand, it's like a critical part of American history and, like, you know, the racialization of space, like bodies out of place. On the other hand, if it has a kind of lurid, like, I'm here to shock you aspect, then I don't think that that's even actually all that helpful. But, you know, you also see media that at that time used those images at, and that was like part of how people, especially white people and African Americans as well, made sense of their world, right? And so it's an interesting line. It's not, the idea is not necessarily to shock, but like an image where that's like essentially a postcard that people consume, and that adds a layer of like, this is not about confronting you with something you didn't know about. This is like showing you how commonplace that was. And yes, I'm going to warn you, like, what I'm going to show you is hard, but let's compare how commonplace that was and how ordinary it seemed to a lot of people with how striking it is today. And I could even say the same thing for the redlining documents. I mean, you know, when a document says, like, at risk of invasion by Orientals, that's not any term that we would use today. And it's rightly shocking to students. And it's, on the one hand, yes, it's hard stuff to read. On the other hand, like, it's actually the fabric that you move through currently. It's still, it's like, it still matters in that particular way.
And I think, you know, as I continue, my kind of initial opposition to things like trigger warnings was seeing how routinely they were used to actually undermine conversations around race and power and privilege. You know, like what you mentioned about your Real Housewives class, right? That at Duke, for example, that a group of straight white male students, you know, basically protested a gender and women's studies class because they were asked to read out, you know, Fun Home, right? That there wasn't a warning that they were going to have to confront male privilege, and so that, you know, it's like, well, so it just, it's kind of used. There are all these ways in which the kind of critical work of critiquing these very these power dynamics then are used, you know, to kind of undermine them. So that was sort of where my initial, like, I'm not, this is, we're talking about race, we're, you know, we're decentering. But then as I kind of get more experience, I rethink these things. But I think what I make
can
very
tell
clear.
Us what was the kind of material that made the student uncomfortable? I've never encountered this.
So it was the novel I assigned was Jonathan Franzen's Freedom. This was in my suburbs class, and the first part of that book is the female protagonist. It's sort of her background story, and she talks about when she was raped in college.
Okay.
But it was, that was the whole, the re, and on the syllabus, that was chapter two, and the syllabus was on this day, we're talking chapters 1 through 3.
Right.
And be ready, and we're talking 1 through 3, be ready to come talk about it. And so, if you didn't, you know, when students start, yeah, I found this really kind of powerful the way it was, you know, then, I mean, if you didn't read, I don't know that I need to say, oh, here's a brief plot summary of what you're going to cover. So, in that case, I felt, no, that I shouldn't have done anything different, but it did make me think that this was a student that clearly was affected. And so, maybe at the beginning of the book, you know, or whatever, at the first day of class, say, hey, there's going to be different things in different books that some of you might find challenging. Let me know if that's the case. But it's also your job to do the reading. You know, I can't tell, you know, foreground what you're going to, what to expect. So do it in a moment. So.
I mean, I think that speaks to this question that we've kind of already traveled on this path, right? How do you make it a welcoming environment for reflection? You know, my method is a lot of like sort of surrounding a problem, like, you know, historical material, field trips, etc. You know, I think we've kind of covered this to a certain extent. Another thing that is important, I think, is the question of sharing and boundaries, not just time boundaries, but sort of like emotional boundaries, especially if you're dealing with really heavy issues, or maybe somebody is like being confronted with a way that they were thinking that they weren't even aware of. That's like the perfect thing to have happen, but it's like emotionally and temporally costly. Especially doing just like the basic work of like taking longer to respond to a response paper, to assign a grade to a response paper where there's like so much to deal with in there. There's only so much time for office hours. There's only so many people who sort of have the gusto to just, I go to office hours, you know? It's not every student. I don't know, you had any issues?
Yeah, I think for me the balance is always finding that we are covering academic material. And so I want the material to resonate personally, to illuminate or kind of get greater insights into personal experience. But I think sometimes the trap is, and maybe this is somewhat unique in teaching in sort of ethnic studies or American studies, but that personal experience starts to sort of replace the real intellectual work, and where our discussion goes from, okay, we're reading a memoir about this young Latino man growing up in Los Angeles in the 1980s, and it turns into, well, I grew up in LA in the 90s, and like here's what LA was like, you know, if we can find the direct connection, right? Oh, when he was talking about his high school, that was the high school that was down, you know, the street, and so my experience was a little bit different, you know, that's all great, I think, when it's helping us kind of fill in and illuminate the text, but I think that there's always, you know, that line where we're just kind of talking, and there is a value to that, but we are all, ultimately, we started with this text, and I want us to think about the larger ideas of the course, history's recovering, and let's make sure we're speaking to that, so, that's always my kind of thing, is I want personal connections, but I want those framed in the context of the material.
And it can be especially hard to tell someone that their personal story that they shared isn't enough, you know? And it's like that really sort of very crusty sounding, like C. Wright Mills, like connecting like the, you know, personal problems to social issues, or you're the sociologist.
Like the history and personal biography.
Yeah,
right.
Exactly. So yeah, something, I mean, and it's hard to be like, okay, yeah, that's not actually, that's a very good story, and that's like, and especially I think when you're at the intersection of sort of trying to understand experience analytically, doing it through more interpretive methods and having a discussion, it's a lot of the kind of management of class is kind of steering it back to these big issues, right? Rather than sort of focusing in, because especially when you get down to that micro level is like where people will have serious conflicts that it's harder to resolve via this other mediator of like the text or a concept or something like that.
And I think you can have an idea ahead of time what sorts of days are going to elicit more tendency to sort of digress, right? So I do a whole day on Disneyland, so I know that day I'm going to stay focused on like scholarship, and because it's easy for me, like, oh well, when I go to Disney, you know, so because it's like, no, there's a very very clear argument about and so you just know the days that are going to be and I think steering it back, I think that I don't want to say that's irrelevant, you know, but you just want to make sure that we're maybe using if someone shares something that's maybe kind of a little too far afield, then use that as an opportunity for you to kind of restate a question to help kind of redirect or refocus the conversation.
Yeah, and especially, you know, we wrap that up into a lot of the issues that we've been talking about earlier, where like if you factor in, you know, students who are, you know, burdened in the summer and don't have a lot of time to read, they may end up kind of defaulting to that sort of personal story because you've been valorizing analyzing social questions through personal stories, but like, you know, the personal story of like an important memoir, you know, like a kind of foundational text, everything is an example of something, right? But it can't carry the day on its own. And so I especially feel like people will kind of default to the personal because we've been valuing it as a route away from being a little bit underprepared. And recognizing when that happens, that's really hard.
And I think that's, again, where I think in summers, just modeling what you want students to give is good. So I use a lot of, in the summer, a lot of personal anecdotes, right? So I talk about, you know, taking my daughter to Disneyland, but it's as a way to kind of reflect on, I distinctly remember what the point I'm making in the lecture, like being very aware that like this was going on there, right? So I think some of that is a way to both sort of invite that kind of sharing, but in a way that is also critical and engaged with the material.
This is out of place. That's where we are currently. So I think because we're about out of time, rather than doing a sort of group breakdown, we did a little bit of that work already, but if there's other questions or comments, or especially kind of sharing experiences, maybe especially from having maybe GSI'd or been in other classes, and then how does that maybe translate, we'd be really interested to hear what people are kind of concerned about. Or if people are totally good.
When did you guys hold office hours? Because you mentioned that, and I sort of occurred to me that might be a tricky.
It's
like, when would people actually go? It depends what time of day.
I find summer office hours are very rarely attended. So I put them when I want them, when I think is a good time to get in some prep or grading, and I'm. Whenever someone comes, hey, you can have as much time as you want, but I found that trying to make myself at a lot of different times the first summer so that students can find me, they just don't. It's the summer, they...
If you do a sign-up sheet, sometimes
that's another way to do it.
If you really want them to come, then they'll sign up and they'll be like, oh, I've got to go.
Yeah.
And you can even like post on the B course and be like, here's the slots.
Yeah. That's a good way to do it too. And then, and then what I say is if you did not sign up, I'm not in there.
I just put it
when I'm going to be there.
I do. We join in. It's like a scheduling type of website. It's useful. I definitely often say like right after class, or maybe like give yourself half an hour, 45-minute break. Give the students that break. They'll more likely to be around. I've found that students who have like a scheduling conflict won't tell you until it's like the last week.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, I need to come to office hours, but these times don't work. And well, this is the first I've heard of it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I put them when I know I'm going to be there prepping, or I'll do like after class, and that way I know if there's no one there, I after 30 minutes or whatever, it's I'm just like,
yeah.
So that's basically.
Other questions? We do have, I think, still some of those flyers from the MRC for streaming resources. I think that about covers it. Is there anything else you wanted to go over? Great. Thank you guys for coming.
Thank you. Thank you.